You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Bio 190. My name is Kira Mathis and I'm your instructor for those of you that maybe have not been able to catch up yet from our first session last week. Today we're going to be talking about kelp forests and rocky shores. So what I want to do first before we get back to the topic and talk about today's speaker is get an introduction from the Aquarium of the Pacific. So I mentioned last week that we will be going live each week to an exhibit or area of the aquarium where we have Julian and Amanda standing by to kind of introduce us a little bit to what we're going to be talking about. So hello, Julian. Hello, Amanda.
Hello, Kira.
Hi, Julian. So today we're talking about kelp forest. So we have you positioned at our Blue Cavern exhibit. So you want to tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, our Blue Cavern exhibit here at the Aquarium of the Pacific is modeled after a real dive site location off of Catalina Island, and it is a kelp forest habitat. So I don't know how well you can see in the picture that you have. We have a tall kelp that actually appears to be growing here. It's actually artificial, but don't tell our guests. And the nice thing is the fish treat it just like it is the real thing, and you'll see them hanging out in it and living in the different places along in the kelp forest that they would naturally be found.
What kind of animals do we see right there at the bottom that are swimming by?
Ooh, I don't know if you can see this one down here. Is there any way we can move the camera over? Because we have down here in the corner just, it might be too far over. Am I in the way? Ah, oh, I just swam out of view. We have a moray eel. So eels actually spend a lot of their time in these little cracks and crevices because of their slender ribbon-shaped body that they have. They can hide out in those areas. So that one came out, which is kind of neat to see because when you're out in the natural habitat, a lot of times you won't see moray eels come out during the day. They like to stay hidden away. But here at the aquarium, we get to see them come out and swim around because they know they have a nice, safe, protected environment here. Oh, we've got this massive one right in front of me here. This is our giant sea bass. Now, this giant sea bass is not full grown, so they can get even larger than this. We actually even have a model on our wall that shows how large they can grow to be. But this one is probably, it's in its 20s, and they can actually probably live up to 70 years of age, or maybe even longer than that. So very large creatures. And they're very big and, you know, robust creatures, and they, again, hang out at the bottom. We also have swimming by here our leopard shark. And if you look at the leopard shark, he's kind of flat on the bottom side too, and sometimes they can be seen sitting along the bottom. A lot of times people think that sharks need to constantly swim to breathe, but he can actually sit right there on the bottom and pump water through his gills just fine. So they're not always swimming in here, but that one was. So those are some of the main ones that I can see that I can point out to you right now at the lower part of Blue Cavern here.
One of the things that I wanted to point out was that the animals have different layers of the kelp forest that they typically live in. So we got a good view of some of the animals at the bottom there, but there are animals that live in the middle and top, right, that are kind of more specific to those areas.
Yeah, we'll see if we can go up a little bit. You'll notice that we have some animals that have yellow tails, and a lot of times people will think that these are a type of tuna, but these are called yellowtail jacks. So I don't know how clear the color is going to be on your screen, but
we can make it out okay.
That one was not one. Our sea bass kind of coming, our white sea bass coming down a little bit lower. We do have some that you just saw with the yellowtail, so the yellowtail jacks. We have some of these smaller fish up there with the oval sort of shape. They have a little bit of white on the side of them. Those are our half moons, or I'm sorry, those are the opal eyes. We half moons, which are kind of, they have a black spot on them. So we have some sort of midwater dwellers that tend to hang out in the middle parts of the kelp forest. And then up at the very, very top, let's see, a lot of these are kind of mixing. Sometimes you'll find some in the midwater. They'll venture up into the shallower waters as well. A lot of times our white sea bass are actually up at the top. And right now it's kind of hard to tell. There's some up there, but I don't think it's really clear for you to see right now.
Now, Amanda, our Blue Cavern exhibit is modeled after an actual dive site found off of Catalina, right? Do you know if this looks pretty similar?
Actually, they did design it to look just like Blue Cavern. So if you were to go diving in Blue Cavern at Catalina Island, what you would see is very similar to this as far as where they position the rocks, what types of things are growing, and of course, what types of animals you would find in that location as well.
Fantastic. All right, so that gives us just a little introduction to what a kelp forest might look like and how there's those different layers. We're going to be diving into that in just a few. So thank you, Amanda. Thank you, Julian, for checking in with us this week, and we'll see you next week.
All right, bye.
All right, bye, guys. All right, and then before we get started, I introduce Allie. Hi, Allie.
Hi.
Welcome. I want to go over all of the normal stuff that we will talk about at the beginning of the class, such as the assignments that are coming up and anything like that. So just to give you guys the information for today, in your book, you're going to want to read chapter 6, 11, 20, 21, and 45. So that will talk about all of the things that we're going to be discussing today with the Rocky Shores and the Kelp Forest. We have the discussion board open right now, and that will close on Friday. Now, today's discussion board that opens up will close by the start of next week's class, as well the quizzes. So we do have one quiz open from last week and a discussion board. Those are going to be due on Friday, only because we're giving that first week a little bit of extra time to kind of understand how the class works and get Blackboard going. But from here on out, the quizzes and discussion boards will be due by the beginning of next week's class. So make sure you get that done. Also, for the participation points, just a reminder, you have the option of doing a few different things to earn up to 2 points per week. So this is part of your grade. It's very important that you participate. There are a couple of ways. One is you can call in today at for any given time, for any reason, if you want to ask a question, give us a comment, if you want to answer the mystery item, you can call in and you'll automatically get both of your 2 points this week for that. If you're a little bit shyer and you don't want to call in, you can email into Blackboard and they will show us the question here. We'll talk about it live on TV and answer your question or your comment. You can get 1 point for that. Then the other 2 points come from the assignment board or the assignment tab in Blackboard. You can type in a question, so about today, or you can answer the question of the day. So we'll have a question of the day when we do the mystery item. Both of those can also earn you a point. So if you type in a bunch of questions today to the class, that's only going to be worth 1 point. You have to do two different types of participation. So it looks like we actually have our first caller already. So why don't we go to the call real quick? Sorry, Allie, you're going to be a little behind
today.
All right, so it looks like we have Dominique calling. So Dominique, welcome. Are you there?
Hi.
Hi.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, I can hear myself.
Do you have a question or comment?
I had a question on
So why don't you turn your speakers down so that way it's not confusing for you. That'll make it so you can hear us a little bit better. Okay, go ahead. Can you hear us now?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead. What's your question?
It's kind of echoing.
Just turn your volume down on your whatever you're watching us on, your TV or your computer.
I'm sorry.
Okay, you down?
Okay, I have a question about the aquarium.
Yes.
And I can't say the name.
What? An animal?
Yes, it was that big fish.
Oh, the giant sea bass?
Yes.
Okay, what about it?
What do they eat?
Ooh, good question. Do you know what we feed our giant sea bass, Allie?
I mean, they probably...
fish,
yeah.
right? Smaller fish. Yeah, that's typically what we feed them at the aquarium. They'll eat fish, squid. That's usually what we feed out most of the time. And then same kind of thing. They're a slow-moving predator, so they're not going to be ones that are chasing fast fish, usually probably slower animals that live in the kelp forest. All right, thank you. Is any other questions, Dominique?
No, thank you. Thank you.
All right, thanks for calling in.
Thank you.
Right, so Dominique gets her 2 participation points for today. Do we have another call or is the light just still on? I'm not sure. Oh, okay, light went off. All right, perfect. So that's one way you can get your 2 participation points right off the bat there. So make sure you're on top of that each week. You don't want to lose out on 26 really, really easy points. Other things coming up, we're going to have a field trip paper. I'm going to be posting that this week. That will be a big assignment that's worth 25 points. It's going to be due October 14th. And basically for that paper, what we're going to do is ask you to go out into nature. Not aquariums, not zoos. We actually want you out in nature. You're going to be making observations on different interactions that are happening around you and reporting back on them. So it might be, and this will all be in the assignment. We're going to post up in the assignments with all the details of what we're looking for. But we just basically want you to watch, look, observe, talk about maybe some questions that come to mind when you're watching those animals. And it's strictly an observational based paper. You don't need to do any research. You don't need to cite any sources. If you see an animal and you do decide that you want to do a little research and talk about that animal, you can, but you will get docked if you don't properly cite your sources. So you do not have to cite sources yet. We're working on that. However, if you do in the paper, just know that you will be graded on them as well. You also need to take a picture of yourself with a date in your environment. So that means that if you are at the beach watching interactions between birds and crabs, I want a selfie of you at the beach. And I want it date and or the date in the picture there. So make sure you do that. If you have a problem taking pictures and you can't do that, please email me at bio190@lvaop.org and we can discuss something else for you to do. Hopefully that won't be a problem, but if it is, just let me know. All right.
Underwater
selfie, that works too. We were just talking about how warm the water is and how awesome it would be to go snorkeling. So that works too. GoPro footage, take it. All right. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and introduce Allie LeBeau, who is going to be our guest speaker today to help us talk about these rocky shores and kelp forests. Been working with Allie ever since I started. You've been at the aquarium way longer than me.
Forever.
So awesome. I always turn to her and ask her questions, so I'm happy to have her here with me today because she's going to be able to probably answer the questions that I cannot.
Well, I will do my best. I'm really excited to be here. So I have been at the aquarium for about 10 years, which there are people who've been there longer, so respect to them. I've been at the aquarium for about 10 years. Before that, I lived on Catalina Island. So my time on Catalina made me a huge algae and kelp nerd, so I'm really glad that Kira invited me to do the show today to talk about rocky reefs, rocky shores, and kelp forests. They're some of my favorite environments because they're right off of our coast and they're probably the most accessible. So if you have an opportunity to go tide pooling for the assignment for class, if you have an opportunity to go snorkeling, how cool is that Kira is giving you the chance to do that for school. At the aquarium, I'm in the education department, so we work with all kinds of audiences. We work with teachers, schools, the general public, families. We do so many different things, and we have a really great team of people who are excited to share the environment, and I'm really excited to be here today to talk about kelp forests.
Let's do it then.
All right.
All right, so we're going to start with the rocky shore. So we keep saying rocky shore and that kind of thing. What is a rocky shore?
So rocky shore is another way of saying tide pools, basically, right? So rocky shore is when you, not when you go to the beach, because that's sand, but the shore that is made of rocks. And there doesn't have to be a certain size of rocks or a certain number of rocks, but that habitat is different than a sandy beach or wetlands. It's a unique environment, and it's a descriptive name, just rocky shore.
And last week we talked about tides, so we talked about that in Oceanography Day. So we're going to kind of recap on those tides, but these are also called tide pools mm-hmm. because the tides come in and the tides come out, and those rocks essentially trap little pools of water, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. So you look at the picture that we have behind us, and we sort of just see water and rocks, and it almost looks like there's not really anything else there, but the way that the rocks trap the water, which is a really great way of thinking about it, make these really interesting environments to sort of check out. So when you're looking at a big picture, it might not look like there's a lot there, but you look really closely and there are animals that are stuck in pools of water within the rocks.
I'm thinking about this area like right here, right?
Yeah,
like we
exactly.
can just kind of see like a little bit of water in that area there. Oops, can we go back to full screen on that so they can see real quick? Yeah, so this area down here, right, there's gonna be lots of animals that live on those rocks that sometimes they're underwater, sometimes they're out of water.
Yeah, really dynamic environment, constantly changing, always, you know, sometimes exposed to air, sometimes completely submerged. Rocks move, people might move them, different biotic and abiotics, and I know what we'll get there in a second, but just really dynamic environments that are constantly changing, and there's so much sort of to peek around and look at, so it's cool to investigate.
So let's talk real quick, let's recap. We talked last week about how the moon and the sun cause the tides, so mm-hmm. the waters are going back and forth. We have diurnal tides, semi-diurnal, and mixed semi-diurnal tides. Can you go over kind of what those differences are?
Sure, so depending on where you are on the planet, you will either have one high tide and one low tide a day, which is diurnal, so two tides. Here off of the West Coast, we have something a little bit different. We will typically have two high tides and two low tides, and that's sort of the semi-diurnal. But the thing that's a little bit different about the West Coast is that the two high tides aren't exactly the same, and the two low tides aren't exactly the same. So off the West Coast, you will have a high tide and a sort of a slightly lower. They're not so far off. Mm-hmm. They're not drastically different. But you sort of have this flow of the high tide and then down to low tide. And really, if you're interested in going tide pooling, if you're interested in going to the beach, you know, you might be interested in looking at those tide charts and just getting a sense of what the beach is going to look like, what the tide pool is going to look like at that time.
And we actually have some videos of tide pools that are in low tide, high tide, and that tide chart. But real quick, we have another caller. So who do we have on the phone with us now? This is two calls in like the first 15 minutes. This is awesome. So Clark, welcome. What can we do for you?
Well, my phone, my video is kind of like off. Like I only see Sophie at the beginning. So I only have like a question about the assignment. And so I'm like, so for the environment, do you have to be like near water watching it, or can it be like on land?
You're talking about for the field trip assignment, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, that can be anywhere. You can go to a park. You can go to a nature reserve. I know that not everybody lives near water or the ocean. I mean, you could go to a stream or a pond or anything like that. It can be any natural area. So I just use the example of the beach because that's where I live. But yeah, it can be anywhere. So, good question.
Okay, then. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Clark. All right. So real quick, let's go to the low tide picture, please. So it's the tide pool low tide. There we go. Can we pull this full screen real quick, please? So when we go tide pulling, Allie, we basically want to go during low tide, right?
Yeah. So by going during low tide, you have more of the area exposed. If you go at high tide, it's kind of hard to get in there. You're battling the waves. By going at low tide, you have an opportunity to look around more. And you know what? I love this picture because there is so much algae in there, which is pretty neat. That you can see all that kind of green stuff, which when the tide comes back in, it'll be covered up again.
Yeah, and we'll be talking about that again as well. All right, and then if we can go to the high tide. So basically on high tide, this is a different area, so it's a little confusing, but basically in high tide, all of those areas, so if you look at this stuff right here, that's essentially what we were just looking at in the other picture. When that tide goes out, it's not underwater anymore. But here, as the tide comes in, it spends more time underwater, and like Allie said, that makes it for a little bit of a complex dynamic there. We have a comment or question actually from Ashley. What is the highest tide recorded and how are those recorded?
That's a really tough question. So the highest tide, it's sort of regional and local specific. So here in Southern California, when we look at the tides, when we have neap tides, which are the highest high tides and the lowest low tides of the lunar cycle, you know, we're looking at like 6 feet is a really high tide, and maybe like zero, slightly getting into negative, would mm-hmm. be low tide. You know, when you're getting to like 6 or 7 locally, that's really, really high. So it's sort of a regional thing. Here in Long Beach area, Catalina, you'll see that sort of 6 feet fluctuation, but that's here. So you'll have higher tides recorded in other places. And, you know, Kira was mentioning that you can see this is high tide right now because everything's covered in water. If you've never been to a beach before and you go, you can sort of look for clues about uh-huh. where the high tide line is. You can sort of gauge is what, even if you haven't looked beforehand, you can sort of look for clues. Is the sand wet? Is, you know.
Are there rocks with life on it?
Yeah.
Or, even algae, right? Mm-hmm. Like, we're going to talk about kelp in a little bit, but if kelp's washed ashore, you can kind of see that that might have been one of the higher.
That's a great one. Like, that's where the
wave washed it
exactly.
up.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Or even like if there's a little bit of algae on the rocks, then you know that eventually that's going to be underwater. That's probably a good indication of high tide.
Right. We have another comment here from Hale regarding the problem of coral bleaching. What are the ways in which we could possibly reverse coral bleaching and how does it affect life around them? So that's a great question. Today, though, we're not going to be talking so much about coral. We are going to be talking about coral in the next, I think it's next week actually, is when we start to talk about coral. So we're going to come back to that question because we are going to be talking about coral at that time. So no coral in California, right? But let's talk about that real quick.
Well,
we don't really have like...
We don't have coral reefs.
Coral
yeah,
reefs,
we don't
right.
really have coral reefs. We do have some soft coral species. We have, you know, the Gorgonia and the sea fans. We do have some of the hydro coral, but yeah, would not really the completely different environment than
right.
rocky reefs
right.
and kelp forests.
And I think that once we talk about kelp forests today and then jump to coral reefs and wetlands next week, you'll really be able to see the
sense.
Difference and make more mm-hmm. sense. Right. Okay, so back to the tides here. Great questions, guys. Keep it coming. We are going to show you a video of some local waters of a high tide and low tide. So it's just like a 30-second clip. It's going to start out with low tide. So you'll see people kind of down tide pooling where these pools of water are. And then it's going to just quickly jump to about 8 hours later when it's high tide. So if we can show that video real quick. And we don't need sound on this one. It's just loud and windy and people talking. So we've got low tide.
Nah, they're kind of...
Going to be living in those little pools.
Where is this from?
Oh, I think this is Laguna. And then here's the high tide.
Wow.
Everything underwater. So you can really see that front rock there on the top right that was like people were almost able to walk out there and now it's almost completely submerged. So
that looks like it's even a bigger difference between six feet.
Yeah.
It's a bigger.
Perfect. All right, so with that, knowing that there's these kind of different areas where water is a lot of the time or little of the time, create something called zonation. So there's going to be essentially zones on these rocky shores, and we're going to just start to work through those zones. The rocky shore tends to have distinct patterns of where organisms live, and there's lots of interactions that are going to happen here, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, you know, we talked about high tide and low tide, but then it doesn't just happen all of a sudden. Like the water slowly comes in and then it slowly comes out. So there are areas that have similar characteristics and therefore the animals, there's some commonalities and some expectations that we have about who's able to live there. So one of the big things that is going on in the kelp forest is these abiotic factors right. that are really controlling the upper limits. So water is a huge one, right? So the water is there and then it's not there. And when the water's not there, there might be higher temperatures. There's a ton of sun down on the rocks. Even the wave action itself, the force of the wave hitting a rock is gonna mean something for an animal being able to live there or not.
And you said abiotic factors, right? So abiotic factor being something that's non-living. You said water is an abiotic factor.
Mm-hmm.
Water is not living, but it does play a role in where those animals can live or how they have to attach. You said the force of the waves crashing. If you're an animal that needs to live on a rock, you know, or that's where your substrate is, you have to be able to knock it knocked off. So that's not another animal telling you or allowing you to live in that area or not live in that area. It's a non-living thing that puts that limit there that you were talking about. So like you said, sun, wind, drying out is considered an abiotic factor. Salinity changes. So we talked a little bit about this last week. If you're in a tide pool, for example, right, it's salt water, and the tide goes out and it's a super hot day, there's going to be some evaporation, mm-hmm. right? So that'll play a role in salinity changes.
Yeah, or even by dissolved oxygen levels, you know? So if you have these animals that are sort of trapped in pools of water and they're sitting there breathing them, they have to be able to potentially handle lower oxygen levels before the water comes up and takes them back out.
Yeah, absolutely. So we're going to jump into that. There's also biotic factors. So that would mean essentially animal or like mm-hmm. living factors that are going to talk about the lower limits that they
can
live.
Yeah, so that's where we start getting into predation, competition for space, out-competing, being able to, you know, find enough food, have enough things to eat, and just really out-compete. And that's, those biotic factors are the ones that are setting the lower limits at the low tide mark.
Perfect. Real quick, we have Julia. Where does the line to measure the tides begin? So I think that's, she's asking, like, where's the zero mark? So we say that we're plus three or plus seven minus one. Where's that zero line?
So I think,
that would that be like a,
I think it's like just the mean, right?
Right. Is it just or based it's on, like, it's what we would consider sea level, right? So yeah, like basic sea level. I would have to look that up.
Yeah,
I'm not sure.
I don't know if I have a good way of explaining that. I think it's just sort of like the,
average, the mean.
Yeah.
Would it be the average of the day?
No, I think it would be the average for that location.
For the location.
That would be my assumption.
Okay.
There's probably a much better way of explaining that. Maybe we can try to refine our
explanation
of
that. We'll look into that, and then we'll see what we can come up with. And then from Abby, are there certain beaches known for having an overall higher tide than others? Last week we talked about the Bay of Fundy, right? That's a perfect example mm-hmm. where it looks like there was this island and then you could walk to it. So that might be an example. Do you know of any others offhand?
That's
going
to be my example too. That was going to be my example too. But, you know, I think that sort of considering where that is and is some of the reason for why that fluctuation is so large. So, you know, the tides and the high tide to low tide difference is really based on so much of the geology and the continental shelf and what it looks like. So
yeah,
there are lots of those little factors that go into it, but Bay of Fundy would be my example too. Just really the
Abby, why don't you look up some and let us know if you find any others? Maybe you could do a quick Google search or something like places known for extreme high tides or low tides. Okay, we have a couple of calls, so let's go address those really quick. Let's go to our first caller. I see three lights here, so that's fantastic. All right, so we have Jennifer from Chino. Welcome, Jennifer. Do you have a question or comment for us? Are you there? We're not hearing anything in the studio. Nothing yet. All right, maybe we can try another caller. We can come back to Jennifer. Okay, Anna. Anna from Dana Point, welcome. Or Jennifer. Van, we're not hearing anything in the studio right now from the callers.
Hello?
There we go. All right, so do we have Jennifer?
Jennifer, yes.
Hi, Jennifer. All right, you have a question or comment for us?
Yes, I have a question.
Perfect.
I'm wondering what types of animals live in the tide.
Oh, that is a great question.
In the tide pools.
Yeah, so we're actually going to be talking a little bit about that in a little bit. So, for example, we have barnacles, clams, sea stars. We can even find some octopuses there sometimes. So there's a lot of different animals, and we'll be touching base on some of the animals in those different zones. So good question. All right, next caller. Who do we have? I think it was Anna, right? Yes, Anna, go ahead.
Hi. Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
This is Anna. So I live in Dana Point, which is a big beach city, mm-hmm. and I go to the tide pools all the time. And I was wondering if it's true that if you poke sea anemones, they die and they dry out.
Ooh, good question.
If
so if you poke sea anemones, will they dry? They die and dry out. Mm-hmm. So there's a couple of things here. If you poke a sea anemone, you might notice that they kind of squirt water out, right? Because it's really, really important that they hold on to all the water that they can. So I would imagine maybe if you poked it a lot, it would make it dry out. But probably the poking in general, right, would just stress them out and I don't know if it's the exact poking that makes the water come out that makes them dry out and die, but overall, it makes it harder for them, and it's probably not good for them. So I wouldn't recommend it by any means, but yeah, it could make them squirt a lot of water out, and they need that water, so don't do it.
I don't.
Good. All right, tell your friends, right? All right, thanks for calling in, Anna. All right, we have one more caller. Who's our third caller? Let's see, we have Katie calling. Hi, Katie, you called last week, right?
Hi. Hi.
Hi.
I was wondering what the main sources of food are in the tide pool, like what types of food are found in the tide pool.
You said what types of food are found in the tide pools?
Yeah, the main food sources.
Like for other animals or humans?
For the animals.
I think that it's a complex food web, right? I mean, it wouldn't be necessarily a main food source. It's more of like...
algae would probably be a huge source for a lot of those guys. A lot of those snails will probably eat kelp and all the different kinds of seaweeds. And then the sea stars prey on the mussels. And there's a lot of filter feeders in there because they can rely on the wave action. So their filter feeders do pretty well, which is... like the anemones are going to be able to survive because there's enough stuff floating around in the water. So yeah, it's a pretty intricate food web, but it all starts with the primary producers, which are those algae.
Perfect. Yeah, no, I agree. So, all right, thanks guys for calling in. I don't think I've ever had so many calls before, so this is kind of awesome. But you guys are already, it's definitely you, Allie. No, I knew it. No. We're going to have her back every week. So, all right, let's move on to the biotic, or we talked about the biotic factors, right? So living things that set those lower limits, so competition for resources and space. And let's jump in a little bit more. We have something that we call a niche, or like fundamental and realized niche. And I think this is kind of an important thing to talk about. When we talk about these zones, right, can you explain first what a niche is?
Sure. So a niche is sort of an area that a animal is going to be able to occupy. It has all of the right factors in place. The abiotic factors are appropriate. There's the right amount of everything's as it should be, and it could probably live there. So, you know, you can't just take a sea star that lives in a tide pool and throw it into the open ocean and say, oh, I'm sure it'll be okay out there. That's not the right place for it. It doesn't have the conditions that it needs. But there are things like predation and competition, and maybe somebody, a little boy, walks up and just picks him up and throws him in the ocean. Those are factors that are going to contribute to whether or not that animal actually survives.
I like to talk about, when I talk about niches, one of the examples that I give is, like, for example, if you have two birds that like to eat ants, right? Like, so you've got, or like bugs, for example, and they might eat the same thing, but one bird might be adapted to eat at the top of the tree, and one might be adapted to eat at the bottom of the tree. Even though they're eating the same type of bug, one might be better at the top, one might be better at the bottom. So even though they're eating the same
totally
food.
One of my population community ecology papers that I wrote just about that.
We're still on the same team here. But the whole idea is that you can eat the same food, you can live in the same area, but you can't occupy the same niche, right? Like animals.
Niche partitioning?
Exactly. Yeah. So the rule, right, is that no two animals can occupy the same niche. So if both of those animals or both of those birds were trying to eat the same bug at the same place, one essentially is going to outcompete the other. Mm. One's going to be better. They're going to claim that area. So you can eat the same things, you can be in the same areas, but you kind of have this role that you play in that particular area, just like Ali was saying. So it kind of plays an interesting part when you think about, oh, well, hypothetically speaking, right, the sea star should be able to live here, but due to other factors, it might not actually be in that particular spot due to competition or food source or whatever. So it's like the fundamental versus the realized, like what we kind of expect to be okay for the sea star, but then not what it might not actually be that, right?
But I think that's why tide pooling is actually really fun.
Like, yeah,
if
I agree.
If you knew exactly what you were going to see and it looked the same on every single rocky shore, then people wouldn't go tide pooling.
Right.
Right? Because then it would be, oh, rock A, you will find 7 periwinkle snails and 4 limpets and 2 barnacles. It doesn't work like that. There are so many factors at play, and there's just this chance element of it as well. So we know that if there are sea stars in that environment, you are more likely to have a more diverse tide pool.
We're right.
Getting there. You're going to have a more diverse tide pool, but, you know, again, the little kids that come up and go tide pooling, the rock that happens to crash down, the lower tides and because of the time of the month, all those things are going to contribute to what you actually see and what's happening.
No, I totally agree. We're going to skip down a little bit and jump into keystone predators. And keystone predators, I think it's one of the first things that I learned about in tide pools. Like, I remember talking about this when I was like in elementary school, and it didn't quite all click until I was older, but keystone predators are kind of an interesting type of predator.
Yeah, this is a really kind of weird concept. The idea that one predator or one species is more influential on the entire population or entire community. So a sea star, when a sea star is present, it is able to maintain the mussel populations. And if mussels are really good at outcompeting in the tide pool. So if they grow and just are able to outcompete everything, then you will only have mussels. And when you only have mussels, you don't have a very diverse environment. It's not a very healthy environment. But the presence of the keystone predator, which in this case is the sea star, they eat the mussels, which allow the mussels to not take over, which actually means that there's more species. So it's not like either there's only mussels or there's only sea stars, but having sea stars, it's a more influential member of that community.
Yeah, no, that makes perfect sense. So if, like you were saying, so for example, if we were to take the sea stars away, right, mussels, like you said, are good competitors, meaning that there's nothing to control the mussel population. So the sea star, we would call that sea star the keystone predator, the keystone species. Just helps kind of keep the balance overall.
Yep.
All right, so that's going to play an important role as we talk about these zones as well. So we'll jump down now actually and talk about zonation of these tide pools. So we have a tide pool graphic, if we can pull that up really quick, just so you can get an idea. And we'll go full screen on this one. So up here we have this area, the splash zone, and we're going to be talking about that splash zone first. So what does the splash zone mean, Allie?
So the splash zone is the area that is almost always exposed to air. The moisture really only comes from literally a little splashing of the waves. So you're not going to find animals that require a lot of water. You're not going to find those anemones that have to hold on to as much water as possible. But you will still have animals that are part of the tide pool community, smaller limpets, things that can do okay without as much water.
Yeah, one example of that is the acorn barnacle. And barnacles are kind of an interesting animal because they glue their head. And we'll talk about this a little bit more on arthropod and what is it? Arthropod and something other day. It's coming up. Can't remember what we paired it with. I think it's echinoderm. But anyway,
that's a lot in one day.
Yeah, I know. They glue their heads down and essentially create like a little shell around them, and then they filter feed using their feet. So they're not going to need a ton of water, right? But they're just going to be able to go off of those small areas. So can we bring the acorn barnacles up, please?
Yeah, barnacles are really cool. People often think about barnacles just growing on the bottom of boats, you know, things that we have to scrub off. They stick really, really well. So we'll see them even in environments, and you guys can bring it up while I'm talking, it's okay. You'll see them in environments where they can hold on really tightly. And when barnacles were first identified, there was some debate about their classification because they sort of just look like a snail or some other mollusk.
Yeah. Do we have a picture of the acorn barnacle? Can we please bring that up? Maybe? No.
No. Okay.
All right. So coming back, we'll get back to that. Let's go to, we have a question here from Hale. So it says, I have one more question regarding kelp forests. What is the status on kelp forests and sea urchins? I have learned that sea urchins have been in too great of amount that they are eating away too much of kelp forest. And, hold on, I gotta scroll. where'd we go? And there aren't enough of the sea urchins' natural predators, such as sea otters. Thank you for letting me know when you'd answer my previous question. All right, so
this is sort of similar to what we were just talking
about.
So we talked about how sea stars, I'm just going to jump in. we talked about how sea stars are a more influential component to a tide pool environment. And sea otters are similar in that they are a keystone predator in a kelp forest environment. And so what the question's referring to is urchin barrens, when there are not sea otters in a community to control sea urchin numbers, they kind of go out of control. And because urchins are eating the kelp, we are sometimes seeing lots and lots of urchins and not very much kelp. So here in Southern California, we don't really have a permanent large sea otter population. So there are some areas where we're seeing not as much kelp. And those guys are called urchin barrens when that happens.
And we'll be talking about that towards the end of the class as well. I have a really great video on that. Another animal, we had the acorn barnacles, by the way, if we can pull that full screen just so you get an idea. These I only want to show you because I'm sure you've probably seen them before. But these are, in fact, animals. So here's kind of the secreted shell. And then they live right there on the inside. And they're going to be the ones that are pulling their little feather-like feet out and filtering out. So there's a good example. Shore crabs are another example of an animal that might live in this splash zone. And they have really interesting ways of living outside of water for long periods of time, right? Because they have gills, so that means they're breathing essentially from the water.
So these are the guys that sort of create bubbles and kind of put them on their gills. So it's almost like they're packing like a little scuba tank with them because that, like Kira said, they have gills, so they do breathe in the water, but they sort of pack up their gills with bubbles, and then they're able to be out of the water.
And if we go full screen, you'll be able to see the bubbles here on this photo. So if we can go full, there we go. You can see the bubbles right here. So just little bubbles, and that's going to help them. I think that's really cute, actually. Like, oh, it's like a little scuba tank. I'm going to use that. I'm going to steal that. I'm going to use that. It's going to be mine. All right. all right, so Ashley, what is the lowest depth in the tide pools or ocean where you could find baby sea turtles or an octopus? Well, for an octopus, I mean, there's lots of different species, right? So there are species that specifically live in the shallower waters that are around the tide pools, but then we also have deep sea octopuses. We just saw one that was like recorded in deep sea, like thousands of feet, the one that was brooding like 18 months or something like that.
Oh, that's right.
So it's going to range all the way from the surface down to the bottom. It's just not going to be the same species of octopus. I'm not sure what the deepest tidal octopus would go.
I mean, like here in our local waters, you'll see two-spot octopus in tide pools, and they can go down, you know, a little bit. And then as for
the
sea turtles, I would think that would be more, I sort of think of a sandy beach more for sea turtles.
So much a rocky, Well, yeah, because they lay their eggs in sand, so they're not going to be around the tide pool areas. Julia, is the starfish the only keystone predator? In the tide pools, that's the bait, that's like the one that's most famous, but
Yeah, I mean, so we use it depends on the environment and the community. So in a tide pool, the sea star is the keystone predator or keystone species. In a kelp forest, it's sort of more the otter. So it depends on the environment. It's a biological term that's not only assigned to sea stars, it sort of depends on that environment and the conditions in that environment.
Justin has a question. This is about acorn barnacles. Why do they stick themselves to boats? So if you imagine, right, a boat is kind of an ideal place to be because if the boat's moving, or even if it's not really moving, the water's moving, or if you're on the boat, the boat's moving, that's moving through lots of areas, lots of filtration can happen. They're typically looking for a hard substrate that they can anchor down to and then filter feed. So because boats have that nice smooth bottom until barnacles attach, that's usually an ideal spot, an easy place for them to attach. Ashley, where can you see the most sea otters in? Hold on, let me.
Their natural habitat.
Closest to here would be like Monterey Bay, right?
Yeah, I'd say head up north. Monterey Bay, Morro Bay are really good places to go. You can be in the Monterey Bay Aquarium and look out on the water and see otters in their natural habitat.
Yeah, I've seen some of the cutest babies up there. There's one day we were in Morro Bay. I have pictures of it too. This baby was on its, you know, mom's belly, and the mom was trying to go inside of Morro Bay, and the current was just moving out so fast. She was just swimming, and she was not moving. And I was like, oh my gosh, I wish I could help that otter, but you don't want to do that. We'll talk about that on Mammal Day. All right. So we are actually, I think, at a good stopping point right now. Well, no, actually, let's finish. We just have the two other zones. So let's go. We're going to move on to zonation. Then we're going to take a break. So maybe another 5 minutes. We're going to talk about the high intertidal zone. So this is exposed to air for long periods of day or long periods twice a day. So this would be like tides come in, tides come out, mm-hmm. right? So can we pull that tide pool graphic back up, please? So, and we'll go full picture, full screen. There we go. So we're going to be talking essentially about this guy up here, right? So on the highest tide, these animals are underwater. This area is underwater, right? Only on high tide, not mm-hmm. low tide. Okay. All right, let's talk about that one.
Okay, so here's where you're starting to see more wave action being a factor. You are seeing animals that are potentially submerged underwater, so they're able to soak in that water. But then still you're going to have some impact from humans for sure. This is, you know, you might have gotten a little too close to that area. So yeah, you're starting to see more things that are underwater more.
This is where those aggregating anemones might be that you might poke with your finger and they squirt out water. The aggregating anemones also, you'll notice when you're walking, pay attention because they close up to try and conserve water when they're exposed to the sun. They also put like shells on top of their outside to help prevent water from evaporating and then also camouflaging in. So you might be stepping on all these closed up anemones and not even know it. So,
and they can even live in the sand. I mean, you know, even if there's not a rock that it's stuck to, you might see them in the sand covered up with little rocks. Yeah, not even realize that they're there.
Yeah, so something to look for while you're there. All right, let's talk about the middle intertidal. So this is exposed to air briefly once or twice a day. So what would an example like, let's go back to our tidal graphic here.
Yeah, so this is, I think, where you're getting into, I really think this is like the meat of the tide pool, right? This is what people sort of go to the tide pools
for. Go full screen, please.
You can start seeing some of those larger anemones. You can see some snails, some chitons, mussels. Maybe a sea star might get its way up there, but maybe not. This is why you go at lower tide so that you can see that part exposed.
So some examples would be giant green anemone, so a different type of anemone altogether, mossy chitons, and black turban snails. So lots going on here, but it makes sense, right? So on the highest tide, that top layer is underwater. During this middle tide, it's like on the lower tides, you're exposed, but for the most part, you have some water on you pretty much most of the day. But then there's the low intertidal, and this is only exposed during the lowest tides, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, so these are animals that prefer to be underwater all of the time, and it's that rarest event of when they're exposed to the sun. But this is where you start seeing those keyhole limpets. This is where octopus and sea hares and sea stars, these are animals that are going to be underwater and that rare event of them being exposed.
Definitely. All right. We have a question from Abby. How long do low tides normally last? And I think that just depends again on where you are and the time of the month or whatever, right?
So one way to think about it, we said here off of our coast, we'll have two high tides a day and two low tides. So think about today. I wrote this down. The high tide today is in about 45 minutes. And it's not a very high tide. And then I think the next low tide is at midnight. So, you know, if you think about it takes all day to go through that, about 6 or 7 hours. When that high tide and when that low tide is depends on where you are and what time where you are in the lunar cycle. But, you know, around here, average-ish 6-7 hours to go from the high tide to the low tide and back again.
So yeah, and it's not going to just be high tide and then instantly be low tide. So it's going to be working its way back or working its way forward. So when they say the time of 4:28 is high tide, that is the highest it's going to be that mm-hmm. day, right? At 4:28 is the time in which the water will be the highest, mm-hmm. and then at midnight that's the time at which it will be the lowest. But if you went to the tide pools, let's say at 11, there's still going to be a lot exposed. Right. It's just not at its lowest moment mm-hmm. yet, right? All right, so I think we'll stop there. Oh, real quick, Jennifer, do the seagulls affect the population of the tide pools drastically?
I would say that that's another example of a living biotic factor mm-hmm. that could potentially impact it, but that's not their primary food source. They stick really well. There's not a lot of meat on those things. That's not really what sea stars eat. So I don't think that that's a huge impact. If something dies and is sort of loose and sitting up on the edge, maybe, but I don't think that seagulls really go to the tide pools.
All right, so we are going to go to break now. Again, about 5 minutes. We usually do that right around the middle of the class. And get a drink or get a snack or do whatever you got to do. And we will see you back here in about 5 minutes.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Hello, my name is Lyra Harding. I'm a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason why I chose this university was for small classes and interactive programs.
Hello, my name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folktale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as a entertainment, doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. I've had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take a folktale or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what Teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
Hello, my name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
We were just talking about doing this. We're looking up questions here from the break. One of the questions that we were trying to look up is the zero tide. We found a website, though, for NOAA on tide measuring, so we'll have to get back to this later.
Yeah, we were so close to finding the answer.
Yes. All right, anyway, so now that we are back from break, hopefully that was great for you. We're going to do our mystery item for the day. This is just an opportunity to get participation points if you haven't called or wrote in yet today. Or even if you have, you can still participate. But this is our mystery item. I'm going to put it in the middle here. And this is probably an easy one, but we'll see. So if you know what this is, please write or call in. And I think we might be able to get the overhead, maybe. There we go. Yeah. Camera on it. Yep, perfect. Next to the pencil there. So we'll flip it over. Kind of see the sides there a little bit.
Interesting.
All right, so if you have any guesses, let us know. All right, so we're going to move on. We're going to be talking about kelp forests for the remainder of the class. And again, if you have any questions or comments, please feel free to call or write in to us. So kelp forests, we've talked about algae a little bit last week.
Okay.
But kelp forests essentially are algae forests, right? Like, I mean, isn't that essentially what kelp is?
Yeah, I mean, kelp, a lot of people call it seaweed, really recognizable as seaweed. This is one of my favorite things. We are in a really unique location here in Southern California where we have these huge kelp forests. They're not found everywhere around the world. There's only certain areas where this cold water is the right conditions for these really cool underwater forests that are made of plant-like organisms that are really a whole nother kingdom. They're cool.
Sometimes when we think about algae, we might think about it as microscopic mm-hmm. algae, right? Like little green phytoplankton that are floating around the water.
Like I didn't clean my fish tank,
right?
Yeah,
I didn't clean my fish tank or my pool looks green, mm-hmm. right? So those are examples of algae, but the type of algae that we're talking about is not microscopic algae. It's big algae, mm-hmm. right? One of the biggest, or maybe the biggest, bull kelp?
I think, well, in terms of length, the giant kelp is larger, but they're
big.
Very closely related.
They're big, yeah. So can we go full screen on this one? This is bull kelp. Again, just like Allie said, this is the seaweed that we oftentimes refer to at the beach or floating if you're on a boat or whatever. And then I believe we have another great picture of bull kelp as well. There we go.
Yeah, that's a great picture. So these are usually found a little bit deeper than the giant kelp. So the stems and the fronds aren't as tall as the giant kelp. So I think these typically start being seen at about like 60 or 80 feet, but you might have had experience with this because they do become unhooked at the bottom and will float up on the surface. And this is a beautiful picture where you can really see the air bladder right in the middle, and it's really large.
And we'll talk about the parts of the kelp in just a few minutes, too. So hang tight on that one there. Jaceel, hopefully I said your name right. How long does algae take to grow?
Well, what a great question. So giant kelp, which is the predominant feature here in Southern California of our kelp forests, it is an incredibly fast-growing organism. It can grow 2 to 3 1 to 2 feet?
Anywhere between 1 to 3 feet a day.
So average about 2 feet a day, which is incredible because it took me this long to grow this tall. So,
yeah.
And I'm done.
Easy peasy, right? So, and we'll talk about how that's really helpful to humans as well. Question of the day, Paris, sea urchin, Allie, is Paris right?
Yay!
Well, easy.
Yeah, she's right.
It's not living sea urchin. This is a sea urchin test. So mm-hmm. you can imagine that it had all the spines, all these little dots that you see here are where the spines were attached, and we're going to get some really cool up-close video footage of sea urchins in a little bit, and what this bottom looks like, what the mouth would be here on the bottom. So really awesome. Jennifer also came in with a guess, is the mystery item of barnacle shell. Good guess, but as we said, it's the sea urchin. I could totally see that being a barnacle shell. I mean, yeah, it's a good guess there. So, all right, if you are not watching live and you are watching this after, instead of answering what this is, since you now know, since we just said it, you can answer the question about sea urchin barren. So why are there so many sea urchins taking over kelp forest? We mentioned the otters, but there are more than one reason why we have tons of urchins. So let me see what you come up with. Ashley, I've been noticing lower and lower numbers of sea stars in the tide pools. What is the causing factor of this? Wasting disease.
That's a big one.
Yeah. I don't know that scientists know a ton about it, but there just seems to be this disease that's taking over sea stars. Is it just wasting disease, or it's...
Yeah, so it's this naturally occurring disease syndrome that they're seeing in natural habitats that really, it's kind of gross because it just makes the sea star sort of like wither and like disintegrate. It's really, really gross. And so there is some of that that's happening. I mean, that has been happening just over the last year or two.
I'd say like two, we probably heard a little bit about maybe a year and a half or two years ago.
But even before that, I mean, we were saying how important sea stars are to the diversity of the habitats. And a huge thing is protecting certain environments so that they're more pristine, right? So depending on where you're going and what tide pools you're looking at, if they're protected, if they're managed, if there's good information and education about proper tide pooling etiquette, you may see different diversity in Abalone Cove or another place that isn't protected.
So. I mean, like you said, the proper tide pooling rules. You don't mm-hmm. want to have tide pools or those little kids come and throw mm-hmm. sea stars out to the ocean. So
yeah, but the wasting disease definitely is impacting greatly now.
Yeah, and again, they just don't know too much about it, like what's making it, even though it's a natural thing, like mm-hmm. what's making it kind of go into full effect right now. So as far as the algaes, there are a couple of types. We talked about them last week. We have green algaes, red algaes, and then brown algaes. So we can kind of just skip down to the whole brown algae part here. But brown algaes essentially are the ones that we're talking about.
Yeah, right? Brown algaes are kelps. So kelps often are sort of referred to as seaweed. It's the one that you see the most when you're on the beach that's washed up on shore. It's the really predominant feature of kelp forests. So when you go snorkeling, it's what you're going to see. They're usually larger than the other algaes. We do have some, I can't believe you just skipped over.
I know,
green.
But we're going to come back to it.
Okay, all right, okay. But you'll see more of them. So they're kelps, seaweeds, all those brown algaes.
And then I want to, now that we aren't with the pictures of the seaweed, I want to go back to the green algae. So if we can pull up the picture of the dead man's fingers, this is a good example. Like, it just looks totally different.
Totally different. So dead man's fingers is a little squishier. It's almost like spongier. It doesn't have all of the same body parts. So when we get into the body parts of the kelp and we talk about that big air bubble that we saw on the bulk kelp, you're not going to see that on red algaes. You're not going to see that on green algaes. That's specifically for the kelps. But yeah, dead man fingers, not seen as often. It's really cool. It's like spongy and looks like fingers.
Is the ulva is that like the paper, like sea lettuce?
Yeah,
almost.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Ulva is the lettuce, and it looks like you could just pick it and eat it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's a type of green algae, mm-hmm. and it makes sense.
Yeah.
Red algae is another kind, which again looks totally different than mm-hmm. the kelp that we just showed you a few moments ago. That's the one that we're really talking about that builds these kelp forests. Tell me about red algae.
Algaes are really beautiful.
Yeah, I don't know a ton about them.
When you see them in the water, this is actually a really great picture because it's sort of, they get a little fluffier. So again, they're not going to get very large. This is probably about, this clump is probably about the size of your hand, maybe. Just really beautiful red and purple colors, even. and very feathery. They are one of the favorite foods of sea hares. And I've heard some indication that that might be the contributing factor to sort of the like purpley color of the sea hare. I don't know if that's completely accurate, but just really beautiful. Lots of diversity even within the red algaes. And some of them are kind of are the coralline algaes that are a little crunchier.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
So those two different kinds of those red algaes.
And one of the questions that came in from the students from last week as a participation question had to do with the different colors of algaes and, like, why do we have such a variety of color in algaes that photosynthesize, right? Do you know?
Yeah, so I think there's probably a much larger answer to this question that I would have to sort of go remind myself about, but we know chlorophyll is the
driver in photosynthesis, right?
So, you know, you still have chlorophyll in algaes. So I'd need to kind of go and confirm exactly what different chlorophyll, because there are different chlorophylls, right? So when the days start getting shorter and leaves start changing color, they're using different chlorophylls, like chlorophyll A or chlorophyll B, and they're relying on different ones. It's one of the thing, one of the reasons they're changing color. So I guess it would be something along those lines, but I don't remember all the details about that.
All right, perfect. Okay, so let's see. We had a couple questions. I know. Let's go back up. Let's go to Alexandria's question first. So, do squid swim into the tide pools like octopuses do, or do they stay out further where it's deeper? They're pretty much always deep. I don't know of any squid that come into tide pools.
I wouldn't see. Yeah.
Yeah, they're going to be more of an open ocean, deeper cephalopod. All right, let's see. We had a guess. Was it from Lindsay? Is it a dried sea urchin? Yes, you got that right. Good job. And then we have one more that popped up from Jennifer. Don't be sorry. You can keep asking as many questions as you like. What kind of seaweed is the most common for humans to eat? So when we wrap sushi, right, and our nori, what kind is that?
I believe that nori is like a combination of a couple different algaes and then processed together to get nori. So I know, like, my kids now have started eating those little nori
strips
that you get at the store. And I believe that that's processed through a couple different I don't know the exact species that it is.
We'll have to look on that, too. All right, good questions, though. Okay, so what are kelp forests typically made up? We already said they're brown algae, but there are a few specific types of algae that make these kind of long canopy type forests, right?
So these are the giant kelps. This is the Macrocystis. Giant kelp can grow up to 2 feet a day. It can be 100 feet. And it is really the predominant feature. That bull kelp that we talked about before, you'll start seeing that a little bit deeper. And since these can be huge, big, tall forests underwater, you'll have a number of different kelps that create them. And like we talked about with Blue Cavern, we have those zones where you are more likely to see certain animals. And so, like a rainforest on land, you'll have the top, the middle, and the bottom.
And animals that primarily live at the top, middle, or bottom, or just a little bit of overhang there.
Yeah.
Let's go over the actual structure of the kelp so we can see what creates these foresty-like kelp forests.
Yeah.
So first, let's take a look overall at a big kelp. If we can pull this full screen, please.
So this big piece, everything that you're seeing, is called the frond. And you have lots of fronds that make up a forest. And this is a really great picture.
So this whole part
that
right here.
Whole thing would be the frond. Yeah. At the very bottom, it kind of looks like there's a little bit of a root system, and that's the holdfast. And like the name implies, it literally just holds the kelp in place to the rocky structure. So it's analogous to a root system, but it's not really a root system because it doesn't transfer water the way plants on land do.
We have a picture of a holdfast. Can we get the picture of the holdfast up? That would be fantastic. We have pictures for all of these parts, actually. Yeah. So we'll wait for that. I think we have the holdfast coming up. While we're waiting for that, let's go. We'll move on to the next part there.
So the other thing that...
There we go. Holdfast. Can we go full screen on this one? So you were saying they're kind of like roots, but not the same, because this part here, like, it doesn't do any absorption of nutrients. It doesn't
transfer water up, mm-hmm. but just literally the job is to hold on.
It's just really the anchor. It also really provides a wonderful microhabitat for lots of animals. So not uncommon to find little brittle stars. It looks like there's like a little, what is that? Like a little anemone or something.
Like right? This right here?
Yeah, and then there's that orange one.
Oh, right here.
Yeah, right there. Yeah. So there are animals, you could find little octopus in there. It's a nice little safe place for animals to live. But if you think about how tall the organism is and you have just this small little holdfast, it's reasonable that it becomes unhooked and floats up to the top.
And then we'll see it washed ashore. Mm-hmm. We have a caller that's calling in real quick before we move on to the next part of the kelp, which is the stipe. So who do we have? We have Paris. Hi, Paris.
Hi.
So you have a question for us? Go ahead.
I do have a question. I was wondering, why is the kelp, the kelp in the aquarium fake?
So why is it, what's in it again?
Why is the kelp in the aquarium fake? Why don't you have living kelp?
Right. So for a couple of reasons. Remember how Allie mentioned that kelp can grow between 1 and 3 meters a day?
Yes.
Wait. Feet. 1 to 3 feet a day. That's a lot of kelp every single day that have to be harvested off. We also need to have pretty strong flowing currents, and that's not something that we typically mimic in a aquarium environment. So we would have to like have that water constantly moving. So we usually keep it nice and settled. So that's another example. And then because they photosynthesize, just like a plant would, we need lots of sunlight in order to make that all kind of work. And it just seems to be easier to maintain the artificial kelp, and nobody or any animal seems mm-hmm. to mind. So it's a little bit easier to do it that way. It's a lot less maintenance.
So most aquariums have artificial kelp?
As far as I know, I don't.
There are some exhibits, and we have live kelp in some of our mm-hmm. our exhibits, like our North Pacific Preview right. often has live kelp. I think it's just on that scale. It's sort of, like Kira said, sort of just a maintenance thing. That doesn't mean that you'll never see live kelp in an exhibit. I think Birch has their big kelp, has live giant kelp. I know California Science Center was trying to have live kelp for a while. So it's just, it's sort of whatever an aquarium is trying to create, a artificial environment. And there are so many factors that go into that. So depending on that system, that condition, that life support background, the life support system, you know, potentially we could be cleaning out a lot of kelp out of the life support. So for that particular exhibit, we've chosen to have the artificial kelp.
And it makes me wonder, too, when we were saying Monterey, right? Monterey also has an open system.
Very different. Yeah, that's a great point. And actually, I think Birch does as well. Mm-hmm. So the water's is different. Yeah, the water's different.
That makes sense. So, all right, good question, Paris. All right, so we talked about the holdfast on the kelp. Holds literally onto the bottom there as the structure. And then let's talk about the stipe. That's kind of like the stem, right?
Yeah, it's kind of like the stem. It is the stem-like structure. And again, this is going to transport photosynthetic products up and down. It's just holds all the pieces. So off of the stipe, you would have the blades. And blade is, we think of blades of grass, and it's not that different, but basically the leaves are the blades, and they're really large and really flat so that they can absorb as much sunlight as possible in order to do photosynthesis.
Perfect. And then there's the nematocysts, which we talked about on that bull kelp, which mm-hmm. were like the big old bulbs, right, that have air in it, and that mm-hmm. helps to keep them kind of floating in place, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so for this huge 100-foot organism, if it were flat on the bottom, it would be hard to get a lot of sunlight. And so as you go further down into the water column, you're going to lose some of that sunlight. So having the nematocyst or the air bladder hold it up on the top, you're getting it closer to the sunlight.
Sure. All right. Hale, my answer would be that human beings have killed. Oh, well, no, you don't have to answer into here. Just you're going to email that in as far as why we don't or why there are lots of sea urchins that are taking over. So I'm actually going to hold off on that from reading that one, Hale. What you can do for your second participation point is under the assignment or the participation tab. Go ahead and take that exact answer and put it in there, and we'll give you that point there. That way you don't miss your point here. All right. Do we have another caller, or is that from Paris still? I see the light on. Okay, Dominique, you're calling back again. Awesome. Do you have a question for us?
Hi, yes. My question was, I had emailed you, but it was about the squishy thing, the dead man's finger. Why is it called the dead man's finger?
Oh, the algae. So that we had seen earlier. Can we pull the picture of the dead man's finger back up, and we'll show you?
Because it kind of looks like dead man's finger. It's kind of like flat. Well, yeah.
Right there. Oh, can we go full screen, please? So right there, it's kind of like shriveled up. It looks like a finger. Reminds me of like a zombie finger.
And
right?
So it kind of grows like the, in a couple different pieces. So that just looks like one finger.
But there would be like, but these are growing too,
you
right?
You could potentially, yeah. So it kind of like is clumped together almost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just a silly common name for it, right?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, no, like it's not really from a dead man or anything like that. Just kind of how it looks, so. All right, thank you for calling in. All right, so we pretty much went over, the meristem, that's the last part, right?
So the meristem is just the growth point, and it's really beautiful. It's the starting growth point of the kelp, and I think it's really interesting because it almost looks like the little blades, you know, just starting to come off.
Starting to break off there, mm-hmm. like to bud out, right? Mm-hmm. Can we see a picture of the nematocyst? We should have a picture of the nematocyst. Let's see. Maybe?
No.
Maybe not.
Okay.
Okay. All right. No problem. Oh, there we go. So here we have actually the blades. We have a lot of parts mm-hmm. here that we can talk about. So the blades, right? This is kind of like the leaf here. Mm-hmm. And then these are the nematocysts, which are those little air pockets.
Here's a fun fact. You know what kind of air is in there?
What kind?
Carbon monoxide.
Carbon monoxide.
I don't know why.
Huh. Interesting.
That's what I heard.
Huh. I like it. And then there's the stipe, right? So like kind of like the stem. So perfect. There's a little bit. Do we have another call again, or is that still from Dominique?
Oh,
just checking. Okay, perfect. Thanks. All right. So we have a video now that we'll show you. It's kind of a cool underwater video that'll just show you what it's like to dive around in a kelp forest. So if we can play, it's about, I don't know, not quite a minute, just under a minute. And it'll show you some really beautiful footage.
There's cathedral trees, there's the understory, there's plants and animals all over the place making their living. It's hugely productive. It converts the nutrients of this cold seawater into algae and then plankton and then into fish and then into the seabirds. And so it populates the ocean with fish, it populates the air with birds, and without them, we would have vastly fewer species, a lot less biomass here on the ocean side, and this whole ecosystem, this whole intricate web of life just wouldn't exist.
So it just kind of gives you what it looks like underwater there, and you were going to say why you like the video.
I was just going to say that, the sun doesn't penetrate all the way down. So it's really cool when you're in the kelp forest to sort of see that there are shadows, and when you are diving in there, there are sort of areas of dark and light, and it's neat. It's like
like a forest, right?
Like a forest, yeah.
Alexandria, how come not all algae have air bulbs? Well, it depends on how they're, like the type of algae that it is, right? Kelp specifically is one that is structured like a forest, so it's important that they can float up the water column, right?
Yeah, and some of them are just smaller. So those little red algae that live in tide pools, they don't really get large enough to need to hold themselves up. Just the kelps, only kelp, only the brown algae have air bladders.
Right. All right, and real quick, we kind of touched on this a little bit with the last question that had to do with why we have artificial kelp. I mentioned this a little bit, but why kelp only lives in very certain places in the world. And there's not very many places that you can find kelp forests, right? Like it's like a handful or something.
Yeah, I think
like
something like 7 or so, you know, less than 10 places around the world. So you need to have this rocky coastline. You need to have that hard substrate. So we talked before about what a rocky shore is, and you still need that rocky substrate for the kelp forest in order to be able to establish. You also need really nutrient-rich mm-hmm. water. So when you think about the waters off the coast of California, you don't think of those blue, clear waters of the tropical environments. It's not just, you know, people always say, oh, because they're dirtier here.
Yeah.
And it's not really that they're dirtier. There's more nutrients in it. There's more plants in it. And that nutrient-rich environment is what allows the kelp forest to grow. And as we are saying, one of those reasons that our closed system, it's harder for us to have live kelp in that exhibit. Also low turbidity, meaning just that it's not really turning around, really rough. It doesn't have to be perfectly still and calm, but the factors have to be right for the kelp to be established. Also, if it were really rough and rocky, those holdfasts would constantly be being uprooted, and the habitat really wouldn't ever get established. And ultimately, you need to have those temperate waters, and, mm-hmm. or if you want to call them cold.
Right.
But you know, around here, they're temperate. They're not the hot, warm, tropical. It's sort of the cooler, temperate environment.
Unless it's been recently.
Unless it's this year.
Yeah, and actually we have an image here that we wanted to show. Mm-hmm. It's been so warm recently, and you were saying that there's not as much kelp, right?
Yeah, so you know, Catalina and coast of Southern California is known for its kelp forests. And if you've had a chance to look at kelp forests this year versus other years, there's just not as much kelp. So
Where we are here. I just want to point that out. I don't know if you can see the mouse moving. But look at right here, that's California.
So what Kira is showing you is an anomaly. So the reds and those warmer waters are warmer than normal, and the blues and the darker colors are colder than normal. And what this says to me is that off of our coast, we have had much warmer than usual mm-hmm. water. So, you know, 72, 73, 74 degrees off the coast means less kelp.
Right.
Kelp just doesn't like it.
Doesn't like that hot water. Mm-hmm. All right, we're going to talk about some of the animals that live in the kelp forest, and we'll go over these a little quicker than some of the others. But mammals, we have sea otters, sea lions, and seals. So those are some of the marine mammals that you will find in the kelp forest. For fish, we have kelp fish, which kelp fish blend essentially right into the kelp. I mean, some of them look just like kelp. And then the Garibaldi is a special one.
Yeah, so when we look at animals in the kelp forest, the fish are not those brightly colored fish that we always think of for tropical environments. We think about animals that are sort of brown and blend in, you know, not that everybody camouflages, but they just don't have really dramatic coloration like in tropical environments. But
if we go to the full screen, I just like this on the full screen, that would be awesome.
The big standout is the Garibaldi. So the Garibaldi is this bright orange fish. Anytime a fish has coloration like that, there's some message that it is bringing along with it. And this is the California State Marine Fish, so it's protected by the state. And that bright orange coloration is its way of communicating that it is very territorial. So it will protect its little environment. It's a little bit aggressive if you get too close to it. And that's what it's saying with that orange color.
It'll definitely let you know. We also have the giant sea bass that we saw earlier in the exhibit at the aquarium, and then sheephead. And we'll get into the sheephead and why they're pretty cool during our fish day. We also have invertebrates, some of the ones, there are lots of them that we've already mentioned, the octopus, kelp crab, and purple urchin, so all animals that we're pretty familiar with today. And then in general, kind of the why this is important is that these are big habitats for lots of animals, mm-hmm. right? I mean, lots of animals live in this. I think one of the first things that you even mentioned was how complex, I guess we were talking about tide pools at that point, right?
Yeah.
But same kind of thing, there's a lot of complex food webs mm-hmm. that are in these kelp forests, right?
Yeah, I mean, of course you would guess that many of the animals eat right off of the kelp. There are animals that live in the holdfast. There are little snails and crabs that live on the blades. But then beyond that, there are the larger animals. So there's really interesting food webs, really, really complex food webs, from the plankton to the grazers that are living on the kelp, the different kinds of kelp, all the way up to the mammals. Somebody mentioned seagulls. Seagulls can absolutely be found mm-hmm. in kelp forests. They'll come down from above. Just unique environments and rare environments.
Right.
So off of our coast, there are some that are protected now, including Blue Cavern is actually in a marine protected area. So when we were looking at the exhibit at the aquarium that is modeled after a dive site that is now a protected environment off the coast.
Absolutely. And we mentioned this a little bit earlier, but why kelp's important to us. We're talking about the animals. I mean, all these animals rely on it. It's this huge ecosystem. But humans also harvest this kelp that grows on the surface, and we're able to use that in everyday products.
Yeah, so if you've brushed your teeth today, if you've used shampoo, if you like ice cream, you have probably used kelp today. So kelp has proteins in it that are emulsifiers. So if you look at any product that is creamy, you may see carrageenan or algar or alginate, and those are from kelp, and they make things nice and thick. So let's see, toothpaste, makeup, salad dressing, shampoo. I even got these little jalapeno poppers once. They had kelp in them. They were really yummy. Anything that should be nice and thick and creamy probably has kelp in it.
Nice. All right, we're just about out of time. We have a couple minutes left. So we're going to talk about what's threatening these kelp forests. Now, we talked about sea urchins. I actually have a video I want to jump down and show you. So we are going. I have another video just for the staff here. We're going to skip the video kelp forest hold fast. We're going to jump down to that last video, the sea urchin barren, that I would like to show you because it's really good footage about how these sea urchins are really taking over these kelp forests. So if we can go to that video really quick, that would be fantastic.
Towers are as high as a three-story house, and they can grow by half a meter a day. Life in the kelp is as full of drama as in any other forest, but the cast is less familiar. An army of sea urchins is mounting an attack. The urchin plague strikes at the kelp's holdfasts, their crucial attachments to the rock. Holdfasts are extremely tough. But each urchin has five teeth, which are self-sharpening and are replaced every few months. Urchins fell vast areas of kelp forest, creating clearings known as urchin barrens. Yet barrens is a poor description. Millions of invertebrates invade the seabed.
All right, so that gives you an idea. It really shows you kind of how those kelp, or how those urchins tear those kelp forests apart and how that has become a pretty big issue. Julia, how tall is the largest kelp?
I don't know. I think that giant kelp is 100 feet.
Wow.
Is what I've heard is the most.
That's insane. Mm-hmm. So Allie, real quick, in our last couple of minutes here, why don't you tell me, seconds, and what are the other threats to kelp?
So we talked about how temperatures are a lot warmer this year, and we're seeing the impact on kelp forest. And so if those continue to be the trend, and if we're continuing to have warmer waters, you know, everything from a seasonal fluctuation like El Nino could potentially bring changes. But as we continue to see more and more warmer waters, that's going to impact the environment. It's going to impact where we see kelp forests.
Awesome. All right. So yeah, and of course there's always pollution too. So we'll jump into that a little bit more on our pollution day. So Allie, thanks for joining us
today.
Thank
you for having me.
Thanks for all the great participation. You all did amazing today. We'll make sure everybody gets their points for participation today. Don't forget, if you wrote in questions today, you still need to do one more thing, either answer the question of the day or email in a question for next week. So awesome job. Discussion boards are open for today. Make sure you do those. You need to be properly citing sources in all of your discussion boards. You have that quiz that is due today, another one from last week that's due on Friday. Look for the field trip paper, and if you have any questions, let me know. We'll see you next week.